Okay, so my name is Aya Sato. I'm a staff scientist in the Carlton Lab at iSEMS. And today I will tell you about the biological process that, by which you can pass your DNA information, your DNA genetic information to your children, and how understanding this biological process is important to our health. So as you know, you resemble most of your parents just because you inherit, you have a mixture of genetic information from both of your mother and father. And this is how our genetic information, DNA, looks like. And DNA is actually made composed of four different letters, A, T, G, C. And the sequence of these four different letters specify how what type of proteins are made and functional in our body. And in our cells, DNA is organized by being wrapped around lots of proteins and exist as multiple strings called chromosomes. And this is how chromosomes actually look like in real life. So we have typically 46 chromosomes in every single in one cell, and we inherit 23 from your mother through her egg, and 23, the other 23 is coming from your father through his sperm. And I'd like to emphasize that having exactly 46 chromosomes is critical to our health. So if you had even one too many or one too few chromosomes, then it's most likely you wouldn't be able to survive, and this leads to problems like miscarriage and infertility problems. Or even if you survive to term and are born, you are more likely to be born with developmental abnormalities. So the question is, how are these problems of infertility and miscarriage are coming from? So as you know, our lives start from a single cell. When your mother's egg cell came together with your father's sperm cell, and as I told you, one single egg cell provides 23 chromosomes, and one single sperm cell provides 23 chromosomes, and this restores 46 chromosomes in a fertilized embryo. However, once in a while, our body actually makes mistakes, so that one too many or one too few chromosomes could be packaged in our eggs and sperm, and this leads to the fertilized embryo that has either too many or too few chromosomes and leading to infertility problem. So the biological process that creates eggs and sperm is called meiosis. It's a special type of cell division. In a typical cell divisions, a single cell replicates its DNA and divide once into two cells. In contrast, meiosis, it's a specialized cell division, and it requires two rounds of cell division and to generate sperm and eggs. And these extra steps in cell division makes meiosis a little more complicated, a little more challenging for DNA. So it's been known that we humans are actually not very good at doing this meiosis. So compared to, I'm showing the rate of eggs or sperm or spores that carry correct number of chromosomes. And compared to other organisms, model organisms like yeast or flies or worms or mice, humans has much higher error rate in meiosis. So because healthy offspring is quite essential for the maintenance of species, everyone tries to do meiosis as accurately as possible, but compared to other organisms who can produce 99.99% of good success rate, we human actually have roughly 70 to 90% of eggs, for instance, that carries correct number of chromosomes, which means that 10 to 30% of fertilized human eggs are carrying wrong number of chromosomes. In addition to that, the rate of eggs and sperm that are carrying wrong number of chromosomes increase as we get older. So here I'm showing the rate of babies born with Down syndrome who have 47 chromosomes, so one extra chromosome. So as mother's age goes up, especially from late 30s to 40s, the rate of giving birth of babies with extra chromosomes increase quite rapidly. So this means that when you're young, your meiosis is good and you produce good, relatively good eggs and sperm. Whereas as you get older, you tend to make more errors in meiosis, and this leads to fertility issues. And this kind of infertility problem is estimated to affect 10 to 15% of couples in the society. So therefore, it's quite common issue in the society. So understanding the mechanism, molecular mechanisms of meiosis is very important to understand infertility issues. However, doing meiosis experiments, doing some research on human beings is not that easy. So instead, in our lab, we use this model organism called C. elegans. It's a nematode, it's a tiny worm. However, they are one of the most widely used model organisms in the biology field. And worms are actually quite great to study meiosis because they produce lots of sperm and eggs. And another advantage of using worms is that the majority of genes they have in worms, they function in the same way as they do in humans. So what we learn from these tiny worms could be directly applicable to human health. So one approach we take using these tiny worms is that, for example, we can modify or we can remove whichever genes in worms as we want. So for example, I could remove gene A and in worms and see if this is leading to a fertile worm or infertile worm. And if I get infertile worms at the end, then I know, okay, so this gene A is actually important for meiosis and fertility. So by doing this kind of experiments, we are currently trying to expand the list of important genes for meiosis and fertility. And the question is, how can we use this type of information in our society? So one prospect we can think of is that if you read your DNA sequence and you can specifically look at the important gene, that DNA sequence of important gene that's known to be involved in fertility, for example, and if you had an alteration in this part of DNA sequence, then this would make you realize you have certain risk, and this may influence how you plan your family, for example. And you can do this kind of genetic forecasting with current technology relatively easy. So with modern technology, you can just take up a little bit of your cells from your mouth using cotton swabs, and you can send this sample, your sample, to the company who can analyze and sequence this, who can read the DNA sequence. And this will make you predict or forecast your future reproductive health. And one of the very well-known example of this type of genetic forecasting is breast cancer. Since we have known so much, the breast cancer, the molecular mechanisms of breast cancer has been quite well studied so far, that we know which genes are associated with it. So if you had an alteration in your DNA, then you know that you have pretty good chance of getting breast cancer in the future. And as you probably have already known that the famous actress Angelina Jolie, she actually has this alteration in her DNA, and she has decided, this made her decide to take the breast removal surgery even before she gets this cancer, just to avoid this risk. And you may think this type of medical practice is rather futuristic or very expensive, but actually that's not quite true. So we are already in the era of DNA sequencing, personal DNA sequencing, and personal or precision medicine. So this year, for example, United States, they have decided that they're going to spend about $200 million to analyze 1 million people's DNA sequence. And the idea of this project is that you're going to read the sequence, DNA sequence, of lots of people and compare this information with the knowledge of already existing knowledge about certain diseases or certain how certain medicine or treatment would work in human bodies, and try to forecast or try to predict how the risk of certain diseases, certain health conditions, or how effectively certain type of medicine will work for certain type of people. So as of today, you can analyze your DNA sequence starting from $100. And so it's not too expensive anymore, and the cost is only going, the cost is going down and down now. And already with this technology, you can predict, for example, the risk of diabetes or Parkinson's disease or certain type of cancers. So our hope is that by learning more about meiosis and fertility, we'd like to discover new genes that will let us forecast our reproductive health. And this will give us more power to predict or prepare for our future health. Okay, with that, I'd like to thank your attentions, and I will take your questions.